Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about the balance sheet, what it is, why it's important, what its limitations are, and how to build one in good form. And we talked all about what the heading should look like, and all the different segments, and how it balances, which is really exciting. And then we talked about an IFRS, statement of position, their equivalent of a US GAAP balance sheet, and how it's different, and how the order is more flexible, and the certain things that have to show up as line items within that statement of position. And finally, we talked about some of the required disclosures that have to show up in our US GAAP financial statements. Now we're ready to talk about the final financial statement. You see, we have to do financial statements in a certain order. We do the income statement to get net income so that we can do a statement of retained earnings. We do a statement of retained earnings using net income to get an ending retained earnings so that we can get a balance sheet that balances. Once we have all three, then we can build a statement of cash flow because we're going to need information from all of the others to make this one work. And so with that, let's start talking about what a statement of cash flow looks like and what its purposes are. Basically, we have two main goals with a statement of cash flows. First, we want to provide information about our cash receipts and cash payments during a given period. Second, we want to summarize the operating, investing, and financing activities of a business. This is the one statement that focuses on our cash information. You know, it's interesting. I talk a lot to different student groups and ask them, which piece of information would you most have, cash flows or earnings per share? And they inevitably vote for cash flows. There's that old adage, cash is king. And most people think that from an investor standpoint, it sure is. We want that cash flow information. Now, when we talked about our income statement, we mentioned the fact that cash is important, but earnings per share has been shown to be a better predictor of future performance than cash flow is. So from an investor's perspective, earnings per share tends to be better and more useful than cash flows. From an internal decision standpoint, or from a debt holder's standpoint, cash still is king. When I ask that question to a bunch of accounting professionals, CFOs, controllers, the high-level people, their answer was, I want cash. Why? Because they're focusing on that internal decision-making of the business. So this financial statement, while not the most important from maybe an investor standpoint that's trying to look to the future and decide if they should buy, it is very important from an internal decision-making and a debt holder's perspective that want to focus on, do I have the cash to do what I need to do to stay in business? Because really, at the end of the day, as much as I hate to admit it, since it's more of a finance answer than an accounting answer, cash really is king from the perspective that I have to have cash or my business is gone. So this financial statement really does provide a lot of key information. In addition, it also provides information that I can use for comparison. If I start seeing cash flow from operations negative and net income positive or vice versa, I know there's some kind of issue that I need to dig into more. They should, even though they won't match, they should at least have the same sign. So that's another important idea here with my statement of cash flows, is the way I can use this information to confirm my earnings information. Because this statement is so important, these purposes are another of our key concepts that we need to understand about the financial statements. Let's talk about the sections of our statement of cash flows. And there are three of them. And if you've looked at the statement of cash flows at all in the past, you're familiar with these. If you haven't, well, you should have. I'm just kidding. If you haven't, then hopefully it'll make sense as we go through it. First are operating activities. These are the cash flows from our day-to-day operations, buying and selling inventory, dealing with rent, taking care of our wages and our taxes, etc. All of that goes into our operating section. And really, we want it to match up with net income. So there are a few things that end up in this operating section that you would think, well, maybe they should go somewhere else. They don't, because we want it to match up with net income, and we build this whole section using the worksheet that we did back in our discussion of the accounting cycle. If you haven't done that, you might want to stop the video here, go back and do that discussion, and then come back, because otherwise, it's not going to make a whole lot of sense. The next section is our investing activities. In investing activities, this is the buying and selling of long-term assets. They're the investments that we make to grow the business. Sometimes we're buying them, so that we can grow the business. Sometimes we're selling them off because they're obsolete for us and we need the cash to invest somewhere else. But this is not day-to-day transactions. It's the sale of assets that aren't part of what we normally day-to-day do to run our business. The last section are our financing activities. This is the cash connected to borrowing and repaying loans, if we sell stock, if we pay a dividend. This is the money back to our investors. Debt holders, equity holders. We're paying them back, at least the long-term debt holders, and then the equity holders. So the money that they give us and the money that we give back to them, that goes down here. Now there are two things that are kind of in a weird place that I want to mention, just so that we're not confused as we build one. The first is interest. You'd think that interest expense would go in which section? If you're like most of my students that I have in class, you said financing, right? I pay interest as part of paying back a debt. It should be financing. And you're right. From that perspective, it should be. But one of FASB's goals with the operating section is to have it match up with net income. So you have that check. Wait a minute. Does net income match with cash flows? Is one positive, one negative? We have to keep those consistent. So FASB said, you know, we're going to take interest expense and cash flow for interest and put them up in operating. Operating from the net income perspective with interest expense, cash paid for interest in cash flow from operations from a cash flow perspective. So even though you'd think interest expense would go down in financing, it's going to go up in operating. The other two are dividend revenue or cash received from dividends and interest revenue. Cash received from interest. Those come from long-term investments. You'd think they go in the investing section, but for the same reason as our interest expense or cash paid for interest goes up in operating, we put these two up in operating as well. So all of the interest and dividend revenue all go up in operating. Dividends we pay out, they stay down in financing because there is no expense for dividends. It's not an expense. So we don't have to try to match that one up. So it can stay in financing like we think it ought to. So those are the different sections of our statement of cash flows and the three weird line items that you have to be comfortable with. Now that we've talked about that, it's time to build a statement of cash flows. And we're going to do one for CBDS. So if you played around with our template for our financial statements for CBDS, you probably noticed there's already a spreadsheet set aside for statement of cash flows, and it's all set up and ready to go so that we can build one. So let's go ahead and transfer over to Excel and take a look at this template. So right here at the end is our statement of cash flows. And you can see that I brought our balance sheet information in so we can use it when we do our cash flow decisions, right? Our teeter-totter and our wave. We need our balance sheet for that. And you can see over here that I put in our net income and our expense items. I've linked them in. Now, I just did this as a quick copy and paste. I didn't spend a lot of time on it. And we need to tweak it just a bit before we get started, now that we're doing a real statement of cash flows. So one thing we're going to do is we're going to add in these line items so that we have the actual titles, and then we'll go ahead and tweak one little piece just so that it makes more sense later. Okay? So let's go ahead and add the line items to this. First off, we have our net sales right here. And, you know, I'm going to right justify all of these so that they're easier to keep track of. They won't line up very nicely, but at least we'll be able to see a little bit better what goes where. Rent, revenue. And you can go to your income statement, by the way, and grab all of these. I'm just giving them to you to speed things up so you don't have to toggle back and forth. But we could do that. Cost of goods sold is this $1,000,094. Advertising expense. And then this next one is bad debt expense. Now this one we're actually going to move just so that our line items make more sense later. Remember that bad debt expense, these are the people that we sold to on credit and we think they're going to rip us off. And what we need to do from a cash flow perspective is we need to put that up with our sales. So I'm going to move this line. Or right-click, cut, and I'm going to insert it right here. And then I'm going to need to actually insert an extra row. And if you'll highlight all of these different columns across like this, then it won't mess up anything later on. And then I'm going to come down here, right click, delete, and I'm going to move those cells up. And that should take care of it. Now again, I did that because the cash equivalent of net sales is cash collected from customers. And cash collected from customers includes the fact some people are going to rip me off. So the accrual equivalent is going to be this net amount. I'm going to add these together. So from an accrual perspective, this is what I think I'm actually going to get from my customers. Now I'll use that to get a cash equivalent in just a few minutes when we finish up the worksheet. So we made that one move. Now we're going to go on. This is miscellaneous selling expenses. This is our selling commissions expense, shipping expense, depreciation expense, and executive salaries expense. Next is our insurance expense, miscellaneous administrative expense, office supplies expense, rent expense, utilities expense, and right here we've got one little issue we've got to fix. You can see that this is highlighted in a nice blue box. If I click on this little blue square up in the corner, I'll drag that down. Now I'm not double counting net sales and bad debt expense. And there's my net income. And if we go back to our income statement, there it is. Now we've set up our worksheet, we've talked about our statement of cash flows and why it's important and what its purposes are. When we come back, we'll start actually building the rest of this worksheet and creating a statement of cash flows. I'll see you then.